Hi, I'm Monsignor Jack, and I'm the pastor of St. Peter Parish. I've been here as pastor since 2005, but this is familiar territory for me. My family moved to this area. We moved here from Chicago in 1960, and so St. Peter has really been part of my life for a long time now. It's been part of my family. And I know you're going to have your child baptized in St. Peter Parish, and you'll be part of this parish family too, and we are so happy to have you and your child as part of this great family of St. Peter. We've been around for 180 years, and we're really proud of that.
I, too, was assigned here in 2005, a few months after Father Jack, and I was born and raised in South St. Louis in St. Stephen Proto Martyr Parish, and I've been a priest now for about 13 years. And so it's a great parish, and so happy that you all are having your child baptized here at St. Peter and be part of our parish family.
Burdened be, then I am still and wait here.
Congratulations! Since you are watching this video, you have been blessed by God with the gift of a child, and you are now preparing to present your child for the gift of baptism. All of us here at St. Peter who share the gift of faith with you are rejoicing in this great gift of your child, and that you are bringing them for the sacrament of baptism. You have accepted a new child into your home, and your child is going to be a blessing not only for you and your family, but for our church and for our world as well.
Jason and I were both baptized as infants, and it was a choice that our parents made for us. We grew up in that parish community, and we wanted to give that to our children because it was so important to both of us.
And it was a gift that we could give to each one of the three children. A gift of being part of the church, being part of a greater family.
By the mystery of baptism, your child will be born again in Christ. This sacrament holds immense meaning for your child, for you, and for the community. Through baptism, your child will become a disciple of Jesus, a part of the body of Christ, a member of the Holy Catholic Church, and specifically, a member here at St. Peter Parish. Through baptism, you yourselves are affirming that you will raise your child in the practice of the faith, and that you will do your best in raising your son or daughter to believe in Jesus Christ and to follow him in all of his teachings, entrusted to the apostles and handed down through the centuries by the Catholic Church. Through baptism, our community will be enriched by your child as well, who will grow in the faith, who will share in our concerns, who will serve others as Christ has taught us, and will join us in praise of God around his holy altar in celebrating the sacrifice of the Mass. Jesus said to his disciples, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." In some churches fulfilling this command of Christ, children are baptized at ages 11, 12, and 13 as they choose for themselves by a public profession the faith, the Christian community of where they worship. But here in the Catholic Church, our tradition is steeped in the oldest and longest tradition known, the apostolic tradition, where it states, "First baptize the children. Those of them who can speak for themselves should do so, but the parents or someone of their family should speak for the others." With the Catholic Church celebrating the sacrament when the children are infants, it reveals the trust that is given to you, the parents.
That will be the return to yourself, the return to innocence.
You are entrusted with the responsibility for providing the kind of home where your son or daughter will experience your faith in Jesus in such a way so that one day he or she will choose Christ for themselves.
Prayer is a very common part of our discussion, part of our daily activities, whether it's can't find something around the house, which happens quite a bit with three little girls, you know, gentle, always throw out, say a prayer to St. Anthony.
Yeah, I mean, even if it's as much as our three-year-old is pretty fond of praying for all the kids who get in trouble at school.
And we do that every night.
Pretty yeah, specifically.
Like, just to let them know how important the religion and the Catholic faith is in our life, that we, you know, talk about it daily, just, you know, special intentions for people that are struggling, and also making sure that there's never a time that we wouldn't go to Mass for Holy Days and on a Sunday, because that's what you do as a family when you're raising them in the Catholic faith.
The word baptism means to plunge in the life, suffering, death, and resurrection of Christ. Baptism is a promise and a pledge given by God to your child through the saving act of His Son, Jesus Christ. In a very real way, eternal life begins for your child on that day. For now, death has lost its power and its hold on your child, and death is only one moment on our eternal timelines. By virtue of baptism, Christ promises to be intimately connected to your child through all things, the joys of life, the sufferings of life, and, most importantly, even death itself, in order to raise him or her up on the last day in his resurrection. So the pledge is made and their life of faith begins on their day of baptism, but let's be clear, baptism is not a magic pill. The gift of salvation and eternal life is not automatically given because of him or her receiving baptism. Instead, the gift of baptism calls for and demands a way of life that follows Jesus Christ and strives to follow all of his teachings faithfully. You are called to be the first and best teachers in the ways of faith for your child. So it begins at home, by your witness, and by your commitment, that your child will be open to the grace of Jesus Christ that only begins with their baptism.
And actually, our two-year-old will walk down and he knows prayer hands, and he already knows the sign of the cross, and just instilling that so early makes it seem like it's just part of your life at an early age, and there's not a question about it, and they just are constantly learning new parts of the Catholic faith. And it's
our oldest, she really enjoys praying the rosary as a family, and asks to do it regularly. So that's really kind of eye-opening when your kid comes to you and says, "Mom, I think we should pray a rosary tonight."
And we have always taken our kids to Mass from the day they were born, and they've always gone. So it really isn't an issue. The older they get, I feel like they're so used to it. We still have problems, obviously, but it's not the intermittent heading to Mass and then you're so worried about how they're going to act because they've been there since they were born.
One important dimension of baptism is choosing godparents. The role of godparent is a great privilege and an honor. Choosing your godparents, it's important to remember that the most essential quality you're looking for in choosing them is that they are persons of faith. Godparents are chosen to be role models and witnesses of faith, thus assisting you, the parents, in achieving your mission given by God to raise your child as a faithful follower of Christ. The godparents represent the larger church, and they are to always stand ready to assure your child that the community is there for him or her to support them in their life of faith. The church invites godparents into a special relationship with their godchild. The qualifications for one to be a godparent is as follows. First, they are to be a full member of the church. This means they themselves have received baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist. Second, they must be 16 years of age. Third, they must be active in practicing their faith. Fourth, the two godparents for your child must be one man and one woman. This reflects the role of parents as God has designed it to be. Fifth, of the two godparents, at minimum, one must be Catholic and the other must be a Christian in another denomination. In choosing your godparents, it is important to remember that the most significant quality, the essential quality by which you are choosing your godparents, is that they are persons of faith, not just in name, but individuals who truly practice and demonstrate their faith by being active in their parish community and faithfully attending Sunday Mass each week. For the grace of baptism to unfold, not only is it important that the parent's life of faith and witness leads and guides the child, but so too does the life of faith of the Godfather and Godmother, who are believers, able and willing to help the newly baptized on his or her road to Christian life.
We felt like it was important for us to find someone who would be a good sponsor for them, not only that day, but for the future days to come, and looking for people who had a real faith in God that they lived outwardly. We have lots of friends and close family members and cousins that we, I hate to say passed over, but that we could have chosen because of how we feel about them, but we didn't choose them because we didn't feel that maybe their relationship with God was what we wanted for our godparents.
It wasn't anything we came by easily. I think there were some really easy choices could have been made, and sometimes for a couple of situations, we ended up with that person, but really thought it through, really thought what it meant, what it was going to mean to them, what it would mean to us, what it was going to mean to our child.
The direction of choosing people that we truly see as examples of living out the Catholic faith, and so we ventured out from just immediate family members, brothers and sisters, and had asked my cousin and his wife.
I even had a conversation with her because we were very, very close as in on a personal relationship. We're super close, but I knew and she knows that she was not the right person to help guide a child in the Catholic faith. And you know.
As we take a look at the ceremony of baptism now, there are a number of symbols that are used. The sign of the cross. This, of course, is how we sign ourselves in all of our liturgies and with all of our prayers. We make this gesture as frequently as we do as a reminder and a statement to ourselves that it is by the cross of Jesus Christ that we are saved from our sins and from death. In the rite of baptism, it is the sign that the priest, parents, and godparents will trace on the child's forehead toward the beginning of the celebration, acknowledging Christ's claim on this child and the bond the child now shares with Christ, earned by his passion and death. Oil. During the ceremony, there will be two separate anointings that use two distinct holy oils. In the first anointing, the minister of baptism uses the oil of catechumens. In the second anointing, the oil that he uses is sacred chrism. The oil of catechumens is used to anoint the breast of the child. In ancient times, warriors covered themselves in oil, for it symbolized strength. With the oil of catechumens, the child is now ushered away from the power of Satan and the power of darkness, and strengthened for the life of Christ to dwell within him or her always as a temple of God. The second anointing, which uses the sacred chrism, takes place following the baptism itself. Chrism comes from the name Christ, which means anointed. As a child is anointed with the sacred chrism on the crown of their head, they are literally made into another Christ, who shares in Christ's mission as priest, prophet, and king. The newly baptized is given the charge to go forth and proclaim the gospel with his or her life. This anointing represents the sealing of the child with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Water. Water is the primary symbol in baptism. Water signifies a number of things in baptism. Namely, water gives life, as it is necessary for one to drink in order to live. Water is also used to wash ourselves and to clean ourselves. Water, though, in overabundance, has the reverse effect of giving life, and instead takes it away. These three elements of water signify and symbolize what takes place in the sacrament of baptism spiritually. Baptism is a birth into new life of Christ. This happens simultaneously when an overabundance of water leads to death of the old life of sin and birth into the new life of Christ. And baptism through water washes away original sin. The white garment. It signifies a new dignity in Christ's death and resurrection. The child has clothed himself or herself in Christ and become a new creation and is now known as a child of God. The candle. The candle is given to the child and is entrusted to the parents and godparents. This is known as the baptismal candle. The baptismal candle takes its light from the Easter candle, which represents Christ himself, who is the light of the world. The baptismal candle lit from the Easter candle is a symbol and a sign that the child is now a disciple and a child of God, a disciple of Christ, and his or her mission is that of Jesus Christ, to be a light in the world by the life that he or she lives, following in the ways of Jesus Christ.
Do you have a birthday cake for them that day? You better. They'll be expecting it, right? How about on the anniversary of their baptism, January 30th every year, you have another cake for them, put this candle in the cake to remind them this is the day of your baptism.
You have accepted a new child into your home, and your child is going to be a blessing not only for you and your family, but for our church and for our world as well.
Oh!